We are very pleased to host a lecture by Professor Sergei Krih as part of the Forum Rubin. Sergei Krih is a professor at the Faculty of History in Omsk State University. He's the leading Russian scholar of the historiography of the ancient world during the Soviet epoch. His most famous books include The Image of Antiquity in Soviet Historiography, The Soviet Historiography of Antiquity in the Context of World Historiographic Thought, and Another Story, Peripheral Soviet Antiquity Science. His last book, Another Story, Peripheral Soviet Antiquity Science, published in 2020, tells about the fate of Soviet historians of antiquity, especially those who remained on the periphery of historical research. Let's Professor Sergei Krih begin today's lecture now on the crisis elements of the Soviet historiography, case of ancient history.
Thank you. Thanks for the invitation. I will be happy to give a lecture at the School of Historical Studies named after the distinguished historian Zviyavits. Unfortunately, we are not in a real audience, but I will try to do my best. Okay, when Soviet historiography created its own history, its history necessarily began in 1970. Soviet science always celebrated anniversaries. These traditions had survived from Soviet times to our days, and accordingly, this tradition anniversary happens every 5 years. Every 10th anniversary is celebrated as a round number, and every 5th anniversary as a non-round number. Any branch of the Soviet economy reported about its own progress by each of these dates. Such reports formed the Soviet narrative about the history of its own historical scholarship, which eventually embodied in a five-volume book. When Soviet historiographers reported to the authorities, they had begun to date historical development not by round numbers, of course, but by the stages of development of the Soviet society. This principle of the division had remained after the end of Soviet epoch. For example, there is a number of special studies about historical scholarship during the Khrushchev оттепель. I should note already now that relatively few works have been devoted to the Soviet science after the fall. As you can imagine, I don't like this periodization. Even any of its supporters understands that neither in 1917 nor in 1918 Soviet historians did not exist. In scientific knowledge, there is always a choice. We can spend energy trying to save a bad construction or replace it with a better one. If we accept the fact that not only political events influence the development of historical scholarship, then we can use other periodization based on the analysis of factors that are more closely related to scientific development itself. Thus, if we analyze changes in the historical narrative, we can distinguish the phases of development of the Soviet historiography. Another approach, it seems only two scholars in Russia follow it, is highlight the stage of evolution and study the development of scientific institutions, the principles of organizing scientific works, etc. I call this conceptual and institutional approaches to the analysis of Soviet historiography. Also, I should say about the prevailing now anthropological approach, which is based on the evolution of the biographical approach, but in this approach, unfortunately, the political periodization is the most often used. You're probably thinking that now I'm going to begin with enthusiasm to criticize some approaches for the theoretical failure, but this is not the goal of this lecture or in general my studies on this topic. Even not of my colleagues agree with the proposal of the division into approaches, but this doesn't prevent them from achieving high results in the study of Soviet historiography. I just want to show what opportunities the conceptual approaches is given. I use this approach more often, and for this I need to propose an alternative periodization of Soviet science, which differs from the usual based on the political factor. I created it mainly based on the material of the of Soviet historiography of antiquity. I will use examples which are better known to me, but I had the opportunity to make sure that similar processes took place in other fields of Soviet historiography. So I will focus on the following periodization. Proto-Soviet historiography from 1918 to 1929, a Stalinist era, which should be divided into two stages, the formation, 1929 to 1939, and the classic, 1940-1955, the major or post-Stalin era, where stages of correction from 1955 to 1967, unification about 1960 to maybe 1979, and dissolution in 80s. I have already said that the late period of Soviet historiography has been much less studied than the early one, so I am less confident in the last stage of the periodization. In essence, my lecture on how we can characterize Soviet historiography, but we need to remember that not all correct characteristics are useful. If I told you that Soviet scholarship was permanently influenced by ideology, it would be an obvious and therefore uninteresting statement. The entire Soviet culture was in an ideological frame. The whole of Soviet society was under pressure of ideology. This is correct, but not useful remarks. It matters only at the beginning stage of acquaintance with the object, or if you need to give it a political or moral assessment. This role was played by the book Soviet Historiography, published more than 20 years ago. Yuri Afanasyev was the editor and the author of the first chapter in it. Afanasyev designated Soviet historiography as the servant of ideology and denied it a scientific component. Of course, he could not deny the significance of the works of many Soviet historians, but he believed that its value has arisen contrary to the Soviet system. This method opened up great opportunities for writing apologetic biographies of Soviet historians, many of whom has begun to look almost dissident. In addition, it gave rise to a potential historiographic conflict in the form of a memory war, since in some cases a division into heroes and anti-heroes has been beginning. Nowadays, such a conflict has taken place in the research of Soviet medieval historiography. For some scholars, Aaron Gurevich is the hero and the master, and for others, it is his opponent, Alexander Danilov. However, general assessments of Soviet historiography now have become more accurate. For example, Alexander Gordon used the concept of partisanship, partiness. It means following the Bolshevik party's instruction. to characterize Soviet historiography. At the same time, Gordon explained in detail how scientific controversy had existed within partisanship. You can see his book, The French Revolution in Soviet Historiography, but this is too general a description. Its problem is that it is like a frame in which we can fit anything we want. When I choose the topic of this lecture, I wanted to show more detailed features of Soviet scholarship, but no less important. What do I mean by crisis elements? These are the features in Soviet historiography which were its inherent characteristics, but at the same time they created internal tension in it. In the times of change, for example, during the transition from one stage to another, they activated and created conditions for an internal crisis. I guess I can highlight three such features. I'm going to talk about each of them, illustrating general consideration with examples, and then I'll draw a final conclusion. And that's all. First, features, the hierarchy in the using information. When I start teaching my students a course on Soviet historiography of antiquity, I usually start with this characteristic. Of course, they love when I seriously inform them that the Soviet people did not have the internet. But then, as I tell other details, they become sad. In short, in Soviet times, in order to understand what difficulties you would have in intellectual activity, you had to answer three questions. Where are you, who are you, and what topic do you do? You know that nowadays Russia is a large country with not the best logistics. The USSR was even bigger. Although all major cities had airports, most people traveled a long distance by train, and such trips took several days, maybe 3 or 6 days. Meanwhile, regional centers had scientific libraries, but they were very poor in books. Cities were old universities had been created in Romanov's times, were in the best position. Tomsk is the only such university in Siberia, and all scholars living day one the Urals went there to work with old literature. But new literature, especially of foreign publishing houses, was rare in the regional center. I remember that even in the late 19th, the library of my alma mater, Omsk University, had only one or two books on ancient history in English. In the Republican capitals, libraries were in a somewhat better position because each republic of the USSR had its own Academy of Sciences. They could be found all the current Soviet publications, but the libraries of Leningrad and of course Moscow were still in a better position. All editions, including editions of sources and dictionaries, were kept there, and current scientific periodicals were purchased. Nevertheless, even these libraries received new literature from abroad in the best case after a year or and usually from 2 to 5 years. And there were only basic books and journals. And some less popular books and journals were not available. In the USSR, there was a book exchange between libraries, but it had worked slowly and only a few books were sent. If you requested 10 books, you had a chance to get 2 or 3 books about months of waiting. If a scholar was interested in foreign history, He would go to the Russian capitals for walks in libraries. By the way, scholars who were interested in the history of Siberia also should have gone to the capitals because Russia was is a very centralized country, and a lot of documents had been taken out to the central archive. But this is not all. Your personal status was very important. A graduate student and a professor in scientific libraries and archives could receive different amounts of literature to use during the day. In archives, for example, beginning researchers received only five cases, I mean five separate folders. The number of sheets in the folder is often not indicated in the catalog. Therefore, the researcher could get a thick or small file stack. In the second case, the researcher had wasted a day. In Soviet time, professors and academicians could purchase scientific literature from abroad. But the others could not. And of course, they had different possibilities to make a copy of the book. Indologist Alexei Vigasin wrote in his memoir that for the work he had needed a Sanskrit dictionary, which consisted of seven volumes, while in the library only five books were handed out at a time. For those categories that Soviet powers considered less loyal, there were restrictions on education, science, access to archives, travel abroad, and so on. At different times, the descendants of nobles, priests, Cossacks could belong to the disloyal categories. Very often, Jews had some restrictions for admission to graduate school. During the years of the war, Second World War, authorities treated the Germans with suspicion. Finally, in the later period, Soviet powers have banned politically unreliable persons to push history and the other science. Other sciences. Fortunately, the Soviet system was not a very perfect one, but it was strong enough to ruin the lives and careers of many people. Finally, it depended on the topic of your research. Sometimes the library received rare books from abroad, but access to this was closed by the authorities. As a result, no one could read this book. Or the right to read, it could be given to a limited number of people. Some documents could be viewed, but scholars had no possibility to quote from them. And sometimes even somehow mentioned in it and sometimes in somehow mentioned it in his in their publication. Of course, this most often concerned book criticizing the Soviet regime and rarely related to works on ancient history, but sometimes unexpected books had been banned. Researchers had problems copying the book. Copies appeared in the late Soviet period, and all copies were under KGB control and also typewriters. The same Vigasin told how he had tried to get access to the archive to information about Russian-Indian relation in 17th century, but this had been required permission from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. What did all this mean for particular beginning researchers? A researcher, besides the fact that he was dependent on the desire of his older colleagues to share books, copies, or excerpts with him. I don't intend to speak at length about how this helped to create a hierarchy system of relations and limited scholars from the provinces in choosing a theme for study. But I'm going to focus on how this was reflected in the views of Soviet historians. The young researcher knew most of the works in his foreign of his foreign colleagues only in retelling, in the form or form of reviews, which were not so much informing but criticizing. In general, it was a distorted system of coordinates. One might have thought that Soviet scholarship produces about the same amount of scientific output knowledge in all historical topics as Western humanitarians. Of course, when a graduate student started to study foreign history, they understood that this was not true. But the general feelings was like that. And researchers of Russian history generally did not particularly use foreign literature because that was a long, expensive, and ineffective process. Many of Soviet generations have developed a disregard for the foreign scholarship as bourgeois, consisting of weak ideas. Finally, the limited information combined with a disregard for alien science has shifted ethical boundaries. Soviet historians relatively freely borrowed many of achievements from inaccessible works without fear of reproaches of plagiarism. In general, this was part of the Soviet deficit culture. Deficit is a shortage. In a planned economy, possession of rare things or skills implied the possibility of their unofficial exchange for other rare resources. The Soviet economy, in reality, was not based on money, but it was based on the principles of early traditional societies, economies. Soviet science was organized in the same way. Next feature is the problem of narrative unification. You know that scientists who work in the same paradigm develop a single narrative for norms. Such an internal factor as the researchers' competition could counterbalance this trend and sometimes completely stop. But since Soviet science was not an autonomous, but a semi-autonomous social institution that strongly depended on external factors, mainly political and cultural, the process of narrative unification in it seriously influenced the nature of historical scholarship. Proto-Soviet historiography, right here, such a scheme, knew two main types of narrative. Most of the historians used the old factological, essentially positivist type. They had given the facts from which some theory followed, which usually did not claim to explain everything in the world, but took up only the subject of research. The Bolshevik type of historical narrative was usually used not by historians, but by Marxist exegetes. They did not discover new historical facts, but gave the correct interpretation to already known facts from the point of view of Marxist theory, while authors could understand the theory in different ways. After 1929, the situation had changed. Marxist doctrine began to infiltrate with the historical narrative. At the same time, a single and simple interpretation of the doctrine was established. This is how Marxism-Leninism appeared. At the stage of the formation, A historical publicist type of narrative had thinking shape. The historian used emotional vocabulary, criticized bourgeois historiography and other Soviet historians if they misunderstood their theory. In fact, the reasons for criticism most often lay in suspicion of belonging to the party opposition. The factological type of narrative survived, but it also has a common doctrine, at least in the beginning and in the end of the text. Some of my colleagues believe that this was a superficial Marxization for the old scholars, I mean educated in pre-revolutionary Russia. They made a few, these old scholars made a few formal statements after which they could do normal science. I cannot agree with this. Indeed, some historians had to take only a few steps towards the Soviet regime. So Sergei Zhebelev wrote only one article in which he suggested that a slave uprising happened in the time of Mitridates in South Russia on the Bosphorus. Before 1932, the Soviet press had criticized Zhebelev. Then after 1932, he became an honored Soviet historian. He played an important role in the Academy of Sciences and lived peacefully until he died of exhaustion during the blockade of Leningrad. But Zhebelev was an academician. He was far from politics. So he was not dangerous. And his transition to the side of the regime had been perceived as a prestige act. Similarly, Robert Wittier moved from Latvia to Soviet Russia. He had received security guarantees, presumably personally from Stalin, who admired his books, especially popular book about Ivan the Terrible. But most historians feared much more for their lives and freedom. Therefore, they made a greater effort to Marxize their text. And the most important thing, Marxist terminology began to be used throughout the text. Even the historian had been writing a factological narrative. In the classical stage, both types of narrative begin to converge as the general principles of Soviet historical narrative had been developed. Abram Ranovich, Ranovich is a shortcut of Rabinovich, was one of the best authors of this time. He was a specialist in ancient Judaism and early Christianity. At the end of his life, Ranovich wrote a generalizing book, The Hellenism and Its Historical Role, published posthumously in 1950. Unlike authors who wrote in a journalistic style in 1930s, Ranovich was well-educated, knew several ancient and foreign languages, and did not allow himself to use a simple vocabulary. But in essence, his book remains with the framework of the same historical publicist type of narration. In one of my books, I showed in detail that Ranovich's book is the result of the simplification and revision of Rostovtsev's famous work on Hellenism. Of course, I am not suggesting that Ranovich never read anything else or that he was plagiarized. But the type of narration that Ranovich has chosen forced him to select only those facts that should confirm his main idea. Hellenism is an inevitable stage in the slave society evolution. And that is all. By the way, when Aronovich had borrowed many facts and observations from Rostovtsev and reinterpreted them in a Marxist view, he noted that Rostovtsev knew only how to collect facts and did not know how to generalize it. He does not see the forest behind the trees, a Russian proverb that Lenin liked to use and with the help of which Soviet historians often mocked bourgeois writings. However, in the late Soviet period, a more boring type of pathological narrative prevailed. The structure of the historical text, for example, a book, at this time becomes approximately the same. The first chapter was devoted to theory. A lot of quotes from the works of Marx, Engels, Lenin were there. Quotes from Stalin's works did not use longer. Also, a few quotes from decisions of recent congresses of the Communist Party they were presented, and several general formulations, which I would talk about later. Usually, no one read this chapter. The following chapters were very close to the positivist narrative. In these chapters, historians systematized the facts and gave them a minimal theoretical interpretation. In the conclusion, this set of facts broach into line with the general thesis. Often at similar level, I proved what I had wanted to prove. I have been talking about the main stages of historical texts at these three feature of Soviet historiography. What principles formed the basis of the Soviet historical narrative? I could say that Soviet historiography had its own special language, which was based on two principles, an appeal to truth and orthodoxy. What did the appeal to truth mean in the Soviet historical text? The first and the main goal of historical research was to illustrate some already known Marxist laws or concepts of the development of society. You probably know that in 1930s, Soviet historians of antiquity used in their works the concept of the slave revolution, which first sounded in Stalin's speech in 1933. When Soviet historians of those years wrote about the slave revolution, they often had begun with the phrase Stalin's words clarified our understanding of the events of late antiquity. Then a historian had to choose a period of antiquity and found those events that could be interpreted in the Stalinist concept. Thus, fact did not prove the theory, but only adorned it. You probably thought that the situation had changed at least after Stalin's death, and you were absolutely right. Indeed, the case of the slave revolution is very simple. In the post-Stalin era, Soviet historians tried to forget about such cases as exceptions to the rule. But in essence, Soviet scholarship had been functioning in the same way. The most important task for the Soviet historian was to call every historical phenomenon right. Moreover, this phenomenon didn't call by its own historical name, but by the one that Marxist theory suggested. If Soviet historians simply had told about the life of the Bach in ancient Egypt, they didn't fulfill the goal. Their real goal was to determine who back war, and they should have been and they should been slaves or serfs. In the early stages, historians crudely had manipulated the facts. Then they took it into account better, and therefore they used more complicated terms. For example, Gurush evidently is not a slave, but a forced laborer of a slave type. So in the context of Soviet historical scholarship, research is a distant analog of a mythological ritual. That is the use of well-known theory in unknown factual material. The main goal of the text is to represent historical diversity is in a single language and give to the readers their translation or explanation of the conceptual system of the researched historical society into the system of concept of the readers and theoretical manipulation with these terms. By the orthodoxy of Soviet historical scholarship, I mean the duty of every Soviet historian to always see the main principles in the historical process. It looks only like a logical continuation of the appeal to truth, but in Soviet realities, it meant a lot. For historians, it was not enough to show loyalty to a single theory. They should do it the only correct way. The originality of the text writing or in the construction of the narrative or in the choice of the theme were not approved. Of course, a historical book or paper always bears imprints of the author's personality, reflects the peculiarities of his style of writing or his understanding of the theory. But for Soviet historiography, this was not a point of pride. Therefore, on the one hand, the historians tried to reduce their own originality, and on the one other hand, proved to everyone that only this view of history is correct. Moreover, it is the correct view of it is the correct view not only in comparison with bourgeois historians, but also in comparison with Marxist colleagues. It sounds a bit like the struggle of branches in world religions, when the main enemies for the faithful are not strangers, but co-religionists. Who have been declared heretics. Therefore, the Soviet historians were more afraid of making a mistake in terminology than in the knowledge of facts. Of course, this does not mean that historical facts have always been ignored, but let me tell you the story that Vygotsin conveys in his memoirs. In the early 1970s, the Faculty of History of Moscow University, there was a discussion of the third edition of a textbook on the history of the ancient East for universities written by Vsevolod Avdiev. Many Orientalists came from Leningrad and they weren't good with Avdiev. Indeed, in this textbook, many factual errors had been detected. After the drubbing critics, Avdiev was given a response. He limited himself to one phrase. I am glad that none of the comments will allow anyone to suspect me of moving away from Marxism-Leninism, and that's all. By the way, the students had used this textbook from about 1948 to 1978, despite the fact that all three editions were far from ideal. Last feature, the problem of an ideas competition. This problem can be summed up in one place the Soviet historiography, systematic competition of ideas didn't exist. In such a simple form, this statement can be understood wrong. For example, you probably thought that Soviet historians had written identical books expressed in the same touch and had never argued with each other. But even from the first half of my lecture, you could see that everything was at least more complicated. The Soviet historical scholarship survived a series of intense discussions. Various theories were accepted and rejected. And finally, there were winners and losers. Is this all not an evidence for ideas competition, for ideas struggle? I must introduce a couple of concepts to show the specifics of such a struggle of ideas. It is a center of or core and periphery. Let me clarify that I consider the geographical aspect is important, but not decisive in this matter. The center is representative of mainstream historiography, that is ideas, types of narration, and scholars high on the scientific and public space. Peripheral historiography in those scholars who much is those scholars whom much the general scientific paradigm, but at the same time they are not perceived as standard or ordinary. I'm not sure in such a division applied to England or US historiography, but it definitely existed in the Soviet Union. At least I have written a book about it. I divided the main factors into the external and internal groups, and with its help, I determined the historians belonging to the historiographic periphery. External factors make it possible to describe the historian's activities through external characteristics. These factors are publication dynamics, journals and publishing houses, level, citation, geography. I mean, not only the distance to Moscow and Leningrad, but also work in more or less prestigious institutions. Corporation, integration degree of a historian into the community of colleagues. Internal factors are revealed with referring to the historian text. These factors are theoretical, the degree of theoretical independence or uniqueness in relation to the mainstream. Thematic, a historian deals with the same issues as his colleagues or chooses unusual historical issues. And stylistic features in the text structure, their frequency of using Marxist terms, and etc. Of course, it is rare to find the combination of all six factors for one author. I believe to define a peripherality is enough for three or more factors. Using the concept of peripherality allows us to see how different Soviet historiography was. We can find in the peripherality scholars who invented new Marxist concepts and those who generally avoided using even basic ones. For example, in Maria Sergeyenko books, who was of the historian of agrarian Rome, the words slaveholding formation almost absented. Although it seemed inevitable in any Soviet book about antiquity, the relationship between the center and the periphery had a different content throughout the existence of Soviet historiography. They formed during the Stalinist era. Historians at this time were afraid to be on the periphery because this means unorthodoxy. On the contrary, many historians wanted to become part of the core. The historians who wrote the immersive version of the events of a particular period expected this version would be recognized as Orthodox. They would be among the recognized historical front leaders. Historical front is a Soviet expression. The most interesting changes occurred during the correction stage. Many loyal to the Soviet regime historians tried to eliminate obvious contradictions in the description of the historical process. For this purpose, they used ideas from the periphery. In other words, the core tried to establish positive interaction with the periphery. The result of this interaction, however, were almost insignificant. Unviable concepts such as the slave revolution were removed, but a more serious correction was impossible. For example, Soviet historians knew that in the ancient East society, slaveholding was not widely distributed. And nevertheless, they continued to classify them as slaveholding. For Soviet terminology, that was not just a fact. Of course, in the ancient East were slaves, but that also means the main contradiction which developed this society was the antagonism between slaves and their masters. This statement did not respond to the facts. Therefore, it was supplemented with some reservations formalized in accordance with the ideological orthodoxy requirements. The classic scholar Sergei Uchenko and the orientalist Igor Diakonov expressed the most significant reservation in their report on the World Historical Congress in Moscow in 1970. According to this report, Lenin called for taking into account not only the classes' role, but also the state's role for the pre-capitalist society's development. In some Soviet historians' works, for example, Konstantin Zevian's, this reservation was similar to Moses Finley's theory of the spectrum of statism. Does this mean that Soviet historical works were on the same page with world scholarship? When I asked this question, I had begun the final part of the lecture, and I can immediately give an answer, yes and no. Some historians could be demanded at the world scholarship, but Soviet historiography as a rule was absolutely uncompetitive. The reason was that bad ideas never won in the Soviet narrative, if they seemed ideologically impermissible. Slavery as a basic and all-explaining characteristic for ancient societies had remained in school textbook of the late USSR, and with some reservations had continued to dominate in university text. Of course, university lecturers could tell students that reality was a little more complicated, but Soviet historians could not even dream of changing such characteristic in textbooks, at least after 1968. In other words, the political factor made a real competition of ideas almost impossible. And conclusion. Concluding my lecture, I would like to say how the above factors are related to each other and how they led to a crisis in Soviet historiography. I talked about the information use hierarchy in Soviet historiography, and you could imagine how much effort historians had done to achieve the simplest results. Because of this restrictions, reduced the number of potential historians. On the other hand, those who were able to overcome all the obstacles were highly motivated. But the problem was not only that the entrance ticket into historical scholarship was expensive, but also what was waiting for historians inside it. For example, young historians in Soviet times quickly understood that in such conditions, the real value was not only the acquisition of new knowledge, but also the redistribution of existing one. I am not talking about plagiarizing, although such cases had been at the time, but led back for a moment to the type of historical publicist narrative. In essence, it was a translation into the language of the Soviet theory of other historians' discoveries. But if science is not obtained new knowledge, but only transmitted it, it in this case, it begins to perform the function of another social institution, education, not science. Another crisis point is related to the unification of the narrative. Obviously, the text that does not break the reader's habit is best perceived. But the best text is good precisely because it differs from the usual. Accordingly, a high degree of historical narrative unification reduces the chances for good writing. In the Soviet case, we could see an interesting pattern. If the quality of work with the historical material and sources post-Stalin era increased as a rule, then the number of good and interesting texts decreased. Roughly speaking, Soviet historians gradually forgot how to write good scholarly texts. Of course, this statement cannot be proven either through statistics or through content analysis, and it is generated by my own experience. But it cannot be denied that the dominance of professional jargon in historical writing occurred from the 1916 to 1918. As a result, most of the history books were incomprehensible to a wide range of readers. This means that history did not have its own social value and got its cultural legitimacy from the state support. But the state doomed historians to a perverted form of dumbness, which it itself perfectly knew could be expressed in a such phrase, to verbose nothing. Finally, the absence of real competition of ideas led to the fact that even works of talented historians rarely or briefly was of interest outside the Soviet system of touch. The struggle of ideas in Soviet historiography resembled a game with oneself. The Soviet historians could ignore any theoretical innovation in Marxism, but in this case, they could undertake study in a purely positivist type of research, which was obviously archaic in the second half of the 20th century. However, in the 1916s and 1917s, Soviet historiography became immensely popular in the West. A small part of the works was originally published in English and other languages. Some papers were translated by foreign publishers, and thus Soviet historiography entered into a dialogue with the whole world. But in this process, the most interesting thing was the result. I'm going to focus on the one last case from 1963 to 1918. Soviet historians had published 10 books from the series Studies of the History of Slavery in the Ancient World. This series was published as a Soviet response to the rise of interest in slavery study in the West, in particular under the leadership of the German historian Joseph Popp. In short, Soviet historians lost and quite early. The problem was not even that they were not always convincing, but they were extremely unproductive. If at the Fox School a whole book would be devoted to the slavery in the Laurian mines, then Soviet books covered, for example, the entire Hellenism in 322 pages, and it was the largest book in the series. The first seven books were published from 1963 to 1971. In the last 10 years, only three books were published. And Soviet historians, which all times wrote about the slaveholding formation, have almost nothing to tell about slavery. And what is the problem in everything that I was talking about during this lecture? And also that the new generation of historians beginning from the 1970s was less and less interested in socio-economic history, briefly and evenly called Sotsek. They were bored with writing about slavery, and they began to study the history of culture. It was a despised branch of Soviet humanitarian knowledge. As a result, the Soviet historical narrative was in agony even before the collapse of the Soviet Union. And that is all my lecture. Thank you for attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Krieg. I want to ask you about two aspects that appear in the title of your presentation. One is periodization and the other one is crisis. Hearing your analysis, I was wondering why you chose to highlight periodization rather than historiography in general, because hearing you, and without knowing the title of your presentation, I would have assumed that perhaps historiography in general would be an apt description. So I was wondering why you chose periodization as the more important term. And the other one is crisis, which is a very, it's a very strong word, isn't it? Okay. Why crisis and not problems, which is a lighter term? So why do you think it's the issue is really one of a real crisis? And let's start with that, and I'm sure that the others will join us in a minute.
It's a good question. I must say that if we tell about crisis or crises, we must understand that if we we must we can understand it a wide range and in a is a more less more weak term. Soviet historiography was a complicated system. That's why they have its own small crisis in all time of its own history. But the big crisis, of course, was only in the end of old system in about 1970s, 1980. I think that is my answer for your question.
Thank you. Sergei, I'm sure that you have numerous questions and others are welcome to join us. The floor is yours.
Yes, thank you for the very informative lecture. I actually have many questions, and I will ask two questions, and if there are no many questions, I can ask more. So first question, could you tell us more about the academic interactions between Soviet and foreign historians? And I have another question, did the Soviet historians that worked in the periphery of the Soviet Union have more scientific freedom? And also in the, in your lecture, you mentioned the translation of terms in the Soviet historiography. And another question is, how would you appraise the language ability of the Soviet historians who research the history of the Eastern society? I know that during the Stalin epoch, correct applying of the Marxist methodology was considered not less important than scientific merits. So how was the language education, language ability of the Soviet historians?
About first two question, questions. About academic interactions, it was, if you see my scheme, you can see that in other stage, it was other type of interaction. On the proto-Soviet stage, it was mainly not so serious restrictions. In sometimes historians can go to the Europe for half of a year, but there was a big problem with money. After in Stalin's era, it was almost all restrictions. And very, very serious for any historians to give any work to another country without special permission. And after Stalin's era, restrictions were in action. But Soviet regime would to be more democracy for about countries, and that's why they wanted to give some historians the right to go in this country. That's why it was in other stage, the other history of this interaction. About freedom on periphery. Yes, in sometimes it was not best. I can say about another example, Solomon Luria. It's a very interesting example. Luria was a very original historian. A historian, and he was not liked in any in any historian society in proto-Soviet times, in Stalin era, and in 1948 he was on the campaign cosmopolitic campaign, and he lost his chair in Leningrad, and after all his adventures, he lived in Lviv, and in the end of his life, he write the best book of his life, because he write many letters to another historians, to historians from abroad. And it, for him, it was the best time, but it was not good for him to go from the Leningrad. But it was the one of example. For other historians, they could not give these studies of the level of the Luria. And that's why on the periphery, it's not an evolution for it, for them. Many of them, many of talented historians live in very peripheral cities. I don't know how to say. They like to drink. About third question, about how good Soviet historians know news ancient Greek and Eastern languages. If you give education in center, very good. If not, very bad. What is the center for ancient Greek and Roman? Moscow, Leningrad, Kazan, maybe Kiev, and almost all. For other cases, only if you go to these centers for some years and give education as a, in an academic institution. And other, it was a big problem because almost textbook was textbooks was a big problem for a regional center. Thank you.
So Ella is writing.
I have a question in the chat.
Yes.
Yes, I'm. I can answer in this. Is historians had an official union? No, it's not to be because it was an academic structure, and that is all for Soviet authorities. Is it is Soviet historians situated in the broader group of the Soviet intelligentsia that was responsible for the social cultural production for the authorities? Yes, of course. They, but not or only for social cultural production, but only for ideological production. That's why historians in the Soviet times was one of the elite groups in the intelligentsia. Not very very powerful, but elite, and that's why. They suffered from the authorities. Okay, that's all questions. Yeah.
May I? Thank you
very much. Yes, please. Please, Eagle.
Well, Sergei Borisovich, thank you for the lecture.
Thank you.
I was wondering what would be your personal ranking of like top five Soviet series historians. I mean, where does Tarlei stand? So, from that point of view, not ideological, but serious historical study. What would be like the top five?
Top five? not in almost in порядке значимости, как это сказать, in order of importance, not in order of importance,
just but random, yeah.
Yes, Igor Yakonov, of course, I think Maria Sergeyenko, about ancient historians, yes?
Yeah.
They said about ancient historians. It's complicated to say another name. Maybe I try to say it's about it about Vasily Struve. It is a very complicated figure. He is in a very complicated interrelations with power and with ideology, but is very interesting historian. And maybe Sergei Zhebelyov, but he is not Soviet historians in essence of his nature. He is an old historian, and as I say in my lecture, it's a very non-seriously Marxization in his text. And must set about something. I want to say about Vasily Kuzishkin. he is not my favorite historian. He liked to write about Komsomol, about party articles about it. But he is a serious historian, and Elena Steyerman. She, of course, one of the most interesting historians, and I like her works more than works of position. Besides of all this, Steyerman was a truly Marxist historian. She really liked the Marxist theory, but it was a high productive historian and very interesting in his ideas and in his discussion in some questions with the Philip. I have another question about male and female historians. Can see the question. Can you pinpoint differences in versions between male and female historians? Must understand that in Soviet tradition, women historians is normal. It's not a very big deal between male and female version, but when my female students read the books of female historians, they seen the differences. That's why I have no good method to seeing these differences because I have this method.
Sergei, would you like the honor of asking the last question for this session?
Can you tell us more detail about the changes in the Soviet historiography between the death of Stalin and the 20th Congress Party, during which Khrushchev criticized the Stalin cult of personality. Is it correct to consider it as a classical period in the Soviet historiography, as you wrote? Because I wrote your dissertation, and you wrote in it that the beginning of the 50s, and especially the period after the death of Stalin, is the beginning of the period of big discussions in the Soviet historiography. So is it correct to consider it as a classical period of Soviet historiography?
This is a question that my colleagues often ask me. I analyze the text. I have another approach. The text confirm this. I have no political periodization, and that's why for me the events between 1953 and 1956 is not so so important. It's of course political factors is important, but you must understand that when a historian write his text, it was a time between writing and publishing. It was a time between writing and structuring this text in his head. That's why we cannot use the political periodization as a simple method. Alternative narrative. Oh, it's a good question. Not elemental, but alternative narrative. Alternative historical narrative in Soviet times was very, you cannot do that because you was in the system, of using information about it, I say in the first part of my lecture. If you not in this system, you have more freedom, but you cannot publicate your text, the first. And the second, you cannot give, you're not a good professional. You're not a historian. That's why it's not only alternative narrative, it's alternative history. In Soviet times, Soviet times has its own history of alternative history from 1920s to 1918s. It's very interesting, but it's a separate theme, not for this lecture. Sorry.
Thank you very much for taking the time to be with us today. It's almost 90 minutes of Zoom, which is very exhaustive. So thank you very much. And I want, on behalf of all of us, to thank Sergei, our own Sergei, for arranging this opportunity. And for everyone, I hope you are taking care of yourself and your loved ones. And we'll meet here in 2 weeks' time for another Rubin Forum meeting. So thank you very much, and bye-bye.
Thank
for
you.
Now. Bye.
Bye-bye.